Okay, so we are going to start with the workshop, and I would like to ask Pablo, why are we doing this workshop? What are we going to be talking about? I know that you wrote a couple of books, and actually I would like you to tell people how to get the books that you wrote, but that you can do it at the end. You can leave a comment. And the books that you wrote were Piano Solos. Is that right?
Yes. Yes, yes, that's it.
And so you have
basically
two.
Yeah, I have one that is called Tangos de Concierto that I basically wrote for, I was classically trained, and there was a lot of colleagues that were interested in playing tango and couldn't find an arrangement that was actually like fully notated. You know, there was a lot of tango slang that was not on the score. So I tried to make arrangements for them to read and sound pretty much in style. Then I started teaching a lot, which I think is super important. There's a lot of pianists that are hungry for tango. And I released the second book that is Tango for Intermediates. So if you're starting there, it's good. It's like the first steps to learn the style.
So you still need to write the Tango for Beginners?
That's coming next year.
I'm going to start playing piano soon, so...
Nice.
Get to work.
Yes.
So... So the tango for Intermedia is we are going to be working on one of those arrangements, correct?
Yes, we're going to be working on El Amanecer, which is kind of in the middle of the book.
Okay.
The thing is that when I started writing these books, I tried to be as thorough as I could with notation. Meaning that my goal was to make Sibelius, the program, sound tangero-ish. So I actually went to the trouble of writing all the fraseos, all the articulations, all the dynamics. But even then, there are some gestures, you know, more like, I guess they're even physical gestures that you need to go to the source, to the orquesta típica. How was the piano developed on that context? And I think that's the key element to sound tangero when you play solo, because you need to sound like an orchestra.
So I just wanted to say that at the Stowe Tango Music Festival, we are committed to make people have the opportunity to experience what you mentioned before, the physical gestures, and to be close to the people who really made the history of tango. So we brought many of the maestros, and you were there three different years, right? You were in 15, 16, and 19, I believe?
That's correct.
Okay, so unfortunately this year we cannot do that, but we are bringing the maestros online. So we'd like to thank the Argentine Tango Society for making this possible, to all of you, to Jisoo Oak that is letting people in or out if you don't behave. And after that, I just want to pass it to Pablo, and he will start working on the solo. Do people have the chart already?
Does everyone got the chart? Because it's kind of important for you to look at it.
Okay, good. So if you have the chart, you have the link on the chat if you want to check it out and have it open, and Pablo will work with you. So from now on, Pablo, the workshop is all yours.
All right. Okay, so I chose this song particular, this arrangement, because I think it uses a lot of the tango elements that are present in an orchestra. The rhythmic patterns are really present there, the contrast between rhythmic melody and expressive melody. We will talk further afterwards. But I think there's a lot of things that we can learn out of how to perform this arrangement. What we're gonna do is I selected three different versions by different orchestras that play this very song, Pepe Basso, D'Arienzo, and De Angelis. And we will find a lot of similarities, and we will find similarities from the orchestra version to the solo version, and let's see how can we import some of the tools that, that the orchestra pianist uses. All right, so first of all, I'm gonna share a little video with a performance I did on the arrangement with the score. If I can find it, of course. There you go. There you go. Is everyone seeing the big screen?
Yes.
Okay, good. Here we go. So that's what we're going to be working on. So although most of the things, most of the articulations and everything are on the score, are on the page, there are some little details that will be very helpful to bring in some of the style of tango. First of all, I like to divide the arrangement into sections. So you all have the score on your hand? Good. All right, you can see the score now, right? Good. So let's divide this into sections. First section, of course, is the top part, right? The beginning. So this part starts right here. We're gonna call it A. And it goes all the way to right, so it has a first part, then it will repeat on a different octave. And then it goes until measure number 17. This will be the end of A, and the B section will start. B section, you will notice right away that it has a big difference. First part was 100% articulation, first section. You have staccatos, accents, two note slurs, but we don't have like a big legato, an expressive phrase. And on B, we do. We start right there. And then it goes back to the rhythmic phase. But if we look closely, let's take a look at the melody. Right? So that was this part. That if you look closely on measure number 26, we will have the very same melody, but with articulations instead of legato. So instead of, we have, so this second part has a very peculiar thing. It takes the same melody and plays it in two very different ways. First, in an expressive, more legato kind of way. And then on 26, as we were saying, it's rhythmical. It's more related to the first section, right? Like, it has more or less that character. Even if you take a look at the ending of this section, measure 31, it's always working with staccatos, accents, and two note slurs. So this is the end of the B section. And we're going to see what happens next. This part, I'm going to take it from 32. So on measure 42, I'm going back to the first section, right? Or at least that's what it seems like. So what happened with all this legato, kind of with the solo flavor thing is doing there? It's very different from the first section, right? The character is very different. But if we look closely, it's actually build up on the harmony of the first section. So is actually some kind of variation on the first section. So we're going to call it A2. Because actually it plays the, you remember that in the first section we had this phrase that it repeats itself two times. First on the higher octave on measure 2. And then it repeats itself on measure number 10, right here. So actually it's kind of the same melody two times. It's repeated in the same section. And what's happening on the third section that we're seeing is that the first round is taken by this solo thing on top. But when it's going to repeat the melody, it does it almost the same as the first time on the A section. It adds some little things, but it's basically the same thing. So we go to the third section, which is the C. The C part of a tango, of a traditional tango, usually we call it trio. And it's the most contrastant part of the tango with the other two. And in this case, he actually changed the key to the major key. Instead of being in C minor, like the rest of the arrangement, it changes to C major. And changes the character completely. Because in the first section, he used all rhythmic articulations. Then on the second section, he was still on C minor, but he make a contrast using expressive slurs instead of rhythmic articulations. And then the third part, he goes back to the rhythmic and the expressive, but in a different key. So it's very refreshing. So, this part, the major part, it uses a little bit of rhythm, as you can see at the beginning of it. I'm gonna go with red for the rhythmic. You see that I have staccatos all over the place and accents. And this situation goes on until here. And then look at this, expressive. How do I know that part is expressive and not rhythmic? Because I have no staccatos, no articulations, I just have bigger slurs. And let's keep going, still expressive, and then went back to the rhythmic. This contrast between the rhythmic and the expressive is gonna be all over the place, all over tango. Is one of its main characteristics, I think. So after that, the C section concludes, and we have a new and final section. But let's listen to it. Is this a new section? I don't think so. I think it's the first section with another variation. In this case, he took off a little part of the melody. Instead of going, he just went. And And actually then in measure number 70, it goes to the textbook melody again. And the final part, which is super interesting. This part, it's kind of on the harmony of the first section, but it has a lot of 16 notes. It sounds a little more virtuosic than the rest of the piece. And this, my friends, is what we call variación. This is a very standard procedure for tango arrangements, especially from the 40s and the 50s, that was made to show off the virtuosity of bandoneons, usually in orchestral arrangements. And it consists in only on the harmony of one of the sections, that in this case is the first section, just come up with a line in 16 notes that will sound showy. I'm always on the chords of the section. The section, I don't know if I can play it all at once, but so it's actually some sort of really a variation in 16 notes on the first section. So, good. We have then an A3 section. All right, so the basic structure of the arrangement then is A with the rhythmic parts, B more expressive, then we are back. We're going straight to C. No, we have the A, expressive A. A2. We're gonna call it solo. We're gonna see why later. Then the C, major key. And then the A3, which is variación.
Pablo, isn't your B half and half? It starts expressive and then goes rhythmic in the middle of the B?
Yes, it's what I meant is more expressive. Uh-huh. Because actually the C is actually is the same. It's very rare. The A is 100% rhythmic. Usually tangos have a little expressive, and there is a major part of rhythmic or expressive which will give the overall character, but there's always a little bit of the other. And in this case, the A is 100% rhythmic. I think it has to do with all the fractions of the melody. It doesn't sound like a line. It's very difficult to play it as an expressive part for some reason. You could, as we did in A2, just create a very different line, like an expressive line on top of it, but it's difficult to play this very line in an expressive way. All right, so we're gonna go back to first section. We have any questions so far? Is everyone with me? I can't see the chat.
Hello?
Yeah.
Just a question, is it normal to have this form in tango, like form rondo, like A, B, A, C, A, A,
well,
for example, or?
Form in tango is actually very flexible because it's a non-choreographic dance. So the arranger has a lot of freedom when you're writing a piece. There is some little codes that you have to use, like for instance, the variación that we were looking at, you know, this 16 line that goes on a section, That's the cue for the end of the song, usually, on most tangos. So there are some code things that the arranger uses, but there's not a fixed structure. You will find an A, B, C, A, and then, for instance, you can find Canaro en París, which the last part is not the A, but the C. And, you know, it can get confusing. It's not a fixed form. For instance, there is a great example of this in the song Danzarin by Troilo. He starts, the Troilo arrangement starts for the minor section, which is the B section. And then you listen to an arrangement of Danzarin by the same arranger and composer, which was Julián Plaza, for Sexteto Tango, and it starts from the trio. So even the same arranger changes the form. So I wouldn't try to find a fixed form for tango.
Fixed form or something.
No. Yeah. I wouldn't look for that. All right. So first thing. This is a thing that I've seen a lot in students, and there is like this is like the main column of tango, the rhythmic patterns of tango. The first rhythmic pattern, and I'm going to go by importance, and not because I like them more than the other, but for instance, there's full tangos, like full arrangements, that can go on with marcato. Actually, you can find in D'Arienzo Orchestra, this rhythmic pattern is all over the place, and sometimes it's the only rhythmic pattern, which is a very simple one, really. It's just four quarter notes. That's it. But the trick is, how do we play these four quarter notes? Because you're going to have four quarter notes on your right hand as well, right? And the main thing here, I think, it's the difference of articulation. Because the bass line, sometimes it appears legato, sometimes appears without the slur, sometimes it even appears staccato in some arrangements that I've seen, which means like super short. And it's not. This bass line of tango has a very particular way to play it, which is the closest thing I've come up with notation is this. It has like tiny little accents, and it's slur, but it's not legato, because you're not looking for an expressive line. You're not looking for that. You're looking for a more percussive sound, like bum bum bum. You're looking to blend with the bass. So, marcato. The left hand is got to have this feeling, right? Which means that I'm not doing legato at all. I'm not doing this. I'm not trying to be expressive with my left hand. My left hand would be like my bass drum. Of course, this is not staccato either. This is something in the middle, like a non-legato, percussive, accentuated left hand. Let me show you. This would be. And this is exactly what we use when we are in a marcato in an orchestra. If this was an orchestra arrangement, probably the piano will still play the rhythmic pattern, but not the melody on the right hand. So my left hand would be the same, and I will be playing chords on the right, like this. So basically what's happening here is that my left hand has all these characteristics. It's very percussive, kind of legato, and my right hand is super staccato. This is something that we need to keep in mind at all times. Let's say you're classically trained. All the articulations, you know, staccato, accents, tunox, slurs, you're going to use that, but you need to multiply that for about four times at the very least, because articulations are very exaggerated, because we're going to use that contrast between the articulations and the legato later. Okay, enough chit-chat. We're going to go to hear how a marcato was played by D'Arienzo Orchestra. All right, that full 30 seconds of music, all marcato, the only rhythmic pattern. And now I'm going to do a little experiment. What I was trying to tell you is that something like this goes. The chord, it's replicated in different octaves in staccato on the right hand, and on the left hand, I still have this bass line. Which goes like this bass drum that we were talking about. So, and all together will be something like this. So that is what I would play in an orchestral arrangement. And it's so very important that we take this marcato groove or feel into the solo arrangement. That's going to be the thing that's going to make us sound more in style, even though we're playing piano solo. In this case, in the arrangement, we don't have the right hand because it's a solo, so we need to play the melody too. We can't just use our full energy to play the rhythmic pattern, because otherwise there's no melody. So the right hand will have to play the melody, but the left hand, this four quarter notes that you see from measure 10 on, those are marcato quarter notes, and they need to be played like that. And then is when the tango starts to appear in the performance. If we read that as a legato, it would sound like this. And then with marcato feel, will sound more percussive. So on. That's the first tip I got. I heard a lot, even when you play Piazzolla, for instance. Piazzolla, despite what many people say that it's not tango or whatever, it's definitely rooted in these very same concepts. So if you have to play a Piazzolla, let's say, I don't know, Verano Porteño, left hand is still marcato. If you play it like staccato or whatever, it's going to sound out of style. So first tip, marcato, left hand. Percussive, don't slur it, don't play it staccato. Try a percussive non-legato, let's call it.
Pablo, can I ask you something?
Yes.
So when you play the left hand, you are giving not only the four beats, but you're also, sounds to me like you're giving direction to those four beats. And if you disconnect them, they will not have the same direction. For example, if you play the right hand only, without the left hand, could you show us the right hand?
Yes, sure.
On the marcato.
Oh, the right hand on the marcato.
The right hand on the marcato, but no left hand. And now only the left hand. So it seems to me that not only you're not doing a legato or non-staccato, but you're also, there is a connection between the two bars. So those four notes are leading you to the next bar. So you do different dynamics as well.
Yes, but I wouldn't like to think it as a expressive line in that way.
No.
But yeah, I agree. I definitely agree. The marcato is the one that is like the metronome of the orchestra. You have to lead the orchestra into where you want them to go.
Yeah, what I have heard many times is that people will play the four notes equally. So if you play the same articulation, but the four notes equally, the music doesn't move. It doesn't go anywhere.
Right. Yeah, I mean, even there is like a natural accent in the downbeats of the measures and so on and so forth. But yeah, sometimes I don't say that because I don't want the students to think as an expressive line. But of course, you have these inflections in the bass that will delimitate the phrases and the sections. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Of course. Let's talk about articulations. This is super important. When I play staccato in tango, I'm looking for a kind of percussive thing again. This is the permanent contrast in tango. You will find a very rhythmic percussive part that will follow a very expressive and absolutely legato part. So the staccato, sometimes it's so short it's imperceptible. Let's check out the Pepe Vaso version of this very song. So, if you hear the articulation of the bandoneones, it's very sharp. It's very staccato. And if I'm playing with bandoneones, I'm playing the same line, and I go, this fraction of a second that I'm playing the notes longer, it's gonna mess up the whole thing. You need to blend with those articulations of the bandoneon. They are very, very short. If you can hear, my accents are a little exaggerated as well. So I have exaggerated accents, exaggerated staccatos, everything is exaggerated. Because then when I go to the second part, I want the contrast of not having any articulations at all. All right, so going on to the second section, let's hear what De Angelis came up with. Appreciate how the articulation changed completely. It went from the very short and very percussive thing to a very long line and very dynamic, almost without inflection. Let's check it out again. And then in this version, you actually have the same idea that we have in the solo arrangement. You have the first time of this. Legato, and then you will have the very same melody in rhythmic, in its rhythmic version. Let's check that out. Now it comes the rhythmic. Good. Were you able to hear the difference? This contrast is super important, and that's gonna be super helpful when we're taking a look at the solo arrangement to think as an orchestra, because there's many, I would say like 3/4 of the piano solos written for tango. They're like orchestra reductions, so we need to think that way. So let's go to the score again. Still expressive. Now it comes the rhythmic part. There's a little transition and then the melody in rhythmic part. But you see how the contrast is what gives this part flavor. The difference between and see how the articulations are super important in this style. So we had a rhythmic tutti, which means that the whole orchestra is playing that in the on the first section. As we were listening with D'Arienzo, and then an expressive tutti, meaning that the whole orchestra is playing again on the B part with this section. Now, this part is usually played as a solo. Could be a bandoneon solo, could be a piano solo, could be a violin solo. But it's usually led to one instrument to give it more flexibility in phrasing. We're going to listen to that in the arrangement we have selected for today. Let's start with D'Arienzo. Okay, so in this case, it was not a solo, it was a soli, it was a string solo section. And for the first time in the arrangement, something it's there's a combination between expressive and rhythmic. You have all the orchestra playing this marcato pattern that we were talking about, that is very rhythmic, and then on top of that you have a very expressive legato line on the violins. Let's hear that again. Good. So this is a part of the arrangement that is kind of an obligated part. Every arranger has to play this kind of solo line in its arrangement of El Amanecer. Everyone did. Di Sarli, D'Arienzo Basso, everyone. So let's hear the other two arrangements. How did they approach this solo? So the important thing, I guess, here is that we need to hear the tempo fluctuations that he took when he was solo. It took it more freely, I think. Of course, the rhythmic pattern of the orchestra was super steady, but then on top of that, there is some phrasing. This is the difficult part. So I guess the difference between section soli and a solo is that with the section we don't have that many freedom, because you have to agree with a whole bunch of people on how are you going to fluctuate the tempo. But then when you're solo, you can just go. You have a lot more freedom, but your left hand has got to keep the tempo. And here's the tricky part. Let's hear, just in case, what De Angelis came up with. The last one was Pepe Basso on a great piano solo on the Amanecer. But let's hear what Angelis came up with. So again, it's a soli section. Of course, in the solo piano, we can take this expressive line and play it as a solo, because we're actually playing alone. We don't have to agree with anyone else. That's one of the few good things of the quarantine. And so let's go to the chart again, and so we don't lose perspective. Let's take a look on how we play that. If we play it at tempo, it would be. So that's all right, but we need to think this solo as a much more expressive kind of bigger line. And since, of course, in this arrangement, we were alone, right? We were playing solo. So I need to complete the chorus. I can't just play one line. Like in this case, I had to complete the chord. And it would be great if it didn't sound like that. It would be great if it would sound like only one line on top, like timbering the melody. So if we add a little tempo fluctuation and this timbering the melody, should sound something like this. To the way we were playing the first section. All right. Do we have any questions so far? Okay, you can tell me, Hector, if you see a question that needs to be answered.
I think so far we don't have questions. We are talking here, so I tell everybody, if you have a question or a disagreement, you can post it on the chat, and I will, if it's relevant for the moment, or I think that we can answer that at the Q&A, so we will do that. So post it on the chat, and then I will pass it to Pablo.
Great. So we arrived to the third section. And here, as you can, as we've been discussed earlier, we have both. We have rhythmic and expressive. So we need to use that contrast in the same way we did with the second section, with the B section. But the difference here, the contrast here, will be the key change. That's going to be super different. But we have smaller pieces of rhythmic and expressive, so the contrast will be more evident. So it's basically the same thing we did contrast-wise with the B section. And then... So the good news about the third section is that the author, the composer, made sure that the contrast will just built in. So it's in major key, we're pretty much, if we do the contrast between rhythmic and expressive, we're good to go. Now let's talk about the last part. And here there's something that is very important. We have this poco più lento part, which is some sort of elaboration on the first motif, like we talked about how he took out the second part, like the call and answer, the answer is not there. It's not there. So I'm particularly interested in see how are we going to play this. First of all, there's something that you already know, which is what happens with the left hand. left hand, four quarter notes, arpeggio-like bass line, we're looking at a marcato here. So it should be played with the same intention that we played this, because it's basically the same rhythmic pattern. The piano would be playing a similar thing in an orchestral arrangement. And then, how do we play this exactly? Do we go legato? Could be like a phrased solo or something like that? And the answer is no. This variation section comes historically, as we were saying, from a part where the bandoneons were showing off. And not only one bandoneon, but the whole section, the whole bandoneon section. So if the first bandoneon started phrasing, the other bandoneons couldn't phrase, couldn't play along with him, couldn't mix, couldn't merge. So that's out of the question. We have to go a tempo if we want to play all together. And then there is one more thing that will help us play all together, and that is not play legato. If I go, the quality of legatos is much more difficult to merge than a non-legato. And actually, that's what many orchestras did when they had this massive variations, because sometimes here in the piano part, I only wrote one line. But if this was arranged for a bandoneon section, it will probably be like three. And then if you want to merge all that, you need to play non-legato. And I'm open to whatever you have to say about that, Hector, that you're a bandoneonist.
So I wanted to say, I have two things that I'm going to ask you. First of all, I'm going to tell you about the bandoneon thing. We were working the other day with Adele on the variations, and I was explaining to her that with the orchestra, we'll sit the four bandoneons together and practice the variations together. And we not only had to play it at tempo, but also you had to put an accent on the first note of the series of four. Of course, there are different reasons to change the accent, but also you cannot play legato. You cannot play legato because the four bandoneons will not play exactly at the same time, and then everything will be very blurry, very gooey. And so the variations were articulated. They were not staccato. Sometimes they were staccato, like in D'Arienzo, but never legato. I have a couple of questions. I'm going to start with, is the contrast between legato staccato rhythmic changing by phrase typically, or just this piece? And that's from Don.
Oh. This is a characteristic in general of tango. Tango serves itself a lot from this contrast between rhythmic and expressive. I think one of the main characteristics is that they don't mix. Since it's used for a contrast thing, usually you will not hear a part that is expressive and legato at the same time, unless it's played by two different instruments. I'm talking about a line. Usually it's one semi-phrase or phrase or section that is all expressive, and then it comes the rhythmic. Like, even Piazzolla took advantage of that. If you hear, let's say, I don't know, Adios Nonino. That's rhythmic, and then the second part. So Piazzolla actually took the very same concept of tango and just went bigger and went to the whole section. Whole section rhythmic, whole section expressive, but it's basically the the same concept.
Yeah, I think it's a matter of balance where you're going to put staccato. As you said before, if there is a part that is more expressive, they can have some staccato rhythmic section within, but it has to be much smaller portion than the whole section. So you will use it for contrast. I have another question from Katie, and that's how do you, if you can show how to do the octaves, I lost it, but how to do the octaves with the pedals to make it more resonant?
Katie is talking about the bass line of the marcato. Is that what you're asking about, Katie? I'm going
to
assume.
It says how to make the bass octaves more resonant with pedals. So, Katie, if that's your question, what Paolo said, please say yes.
Yes. For example, at the very beginning on bar, in bar 1, 2, 3, between 3 and 4, it's like when the double bass do that really.
Yeah, the arrastre.
Yeah,
that's it.
How do you do that with? Like the timing of the pedal, how do you get it so it sounds sort of like
I put the pedal with the accent on the eighth note before the downbeat. I try to put the pedal with the accent.
And you release it when?
On the rest. The rest needs to be there.
Okay.
So yeah, that's a different rhythmic pattern called syncopa. But yeah.
Yeah, I think there are many things like that probably we will be able to do another workshop and talk about all these techniques. Do you think?
Yeah, that sounds cool.
That'd be great.
Yeah, so you can continue with the
variation. Yeah, I have it right here.
Yeah.
All right, so let's go to variation by D'Arienzo. Oh, wait, something happened here.
Did the bandoneon start to fight?
They always do.
That's what usually happens, yeah.
All right, let's see. Can you listen to that now? No, me neither.
Nope.
Okay, something happened. Technology happens. I know.
We could hear something.
You did?
Yeah, just very short. Yep.
Wait, I'm gonna go again. Oh man, this is when I really miss the old days when you do that this live.
You miss the old days? Come on.
Yeah, like the old days, like last year.
Okay.
I know. Juan D'Arienzo, there we go. Can you hear that?
Far away, but we can.
Am I sharing sound? Oh, and I'm not sharing sound. That's why.
Yeah. You need an assistant.
Yeah, I do. Sorry about that. Well, we're all back in business now. Okay, so variation by D'Arienzo. I think it was pretty clear. There were They were playing super non legato. I mean, so that's what we have to imitate when we play variaciones, to sound, to try to take this sound from bandoneones.
Actually, I wanted to say that in the orchestra of Pugliese, there was a bandoneon from D'Arienzo, and there were others that, like Alvarez, was not from D'Arienzo. But we will go through the variations in different ways. We'll play it very staccato with a lot of accent on the first note, then switch to not too staccato, although articulated. We never got to the legato. That happened during the concert, and it was a mess.
Yeah, I mean, you never go legato with a variation. And knowing this, you have several things that you have to keep in mind when you open a brand new solo for piano, for any instrument for that matter. First of all, the quarter notes on the left hand, on the bass line, that's a marcato. There's a way to play that. You can't play staccato, you can't play legato. You gotta look for this percussive sound. Then the other thing that we saw, this permanent contrast between the rhythmic, with these articulations that are very sharp, very short, and very exaggerated, with this legato that uses dynamics and very big lines. And then if you see a lot of 16 notes together towards the end, that's a variation. You should play that non-legato, even though there is a slur. Because that's another thing that is sometimes confusing when you start learning tango. You get scores that are tricky because, for instance, they say that something is legato, it's written down, but it's not. So that's where you need to use your tango orchestra knowledge to be able to say, no, wait, this four quarter notes on the left hand, this can't be legato, this can't be staccato, this is a marcato, so it's got to be percussive and non-legato. And then you take that decision.
I think there were two things that happened with tango. First of all, that nobody put the dynamics, and when they put it, they overdo it. And when they meant non-staccato, they will put slurs.
Yeah.
And that confuses people.
That can be kind of confusing, yes. Bottom line, if you have a traditional tango that you have to play, you got brand new arrangement. First of all, go to the source. Go to the great orchestras and see how they arranged it. See if you can find some similarities with the solo you have, that probably you will find some, because there are some things that are standard to the tango, like this line. In this case, this line is typical. In every arrangement, you will find it. It's not always a solo line. For instance, in Canaro in Paris, another song that you know, what is standard is the variation. Everyone uses this variation. Then, you know, there's a lot of code things that you can find and check out how the big tango giants did it and try to learn something from there. But, see?
No, I was going to say, so we are planning to, you're going to take the music and probably, hopefully, you will feel inspired to learn the music. And we are going to let you know, because my idea is to do another workshop, almost like a masterclass, where some people can play the solo. We did this with bandoneon players, and some people will be able to play the solo, and Pablo can coach the pianist.
That sounds great.
Yeah.
Of course. Everyone has the chart, right? So you're more than welcome to start practicing and contact me if you need any help. Is there any questions that need to be answered?
We have one in here. In orchestra, piano often plays feel in at the end of the phrases. In solo piano, do you leave them out in favor of melody, chords, and bass, or try to add them when possible?
Said feels.
Yeah, piano plays feels at the end of phrases. Yeah, the connections between the phrases or parts.
You mean like a connector, not like an arrastre?
No. That's, I think, what you mean, Don, right?
I don't know the typical terms for that. Sometimes higher notes to fill in between phrases.
What you mean is the transition between two phrases.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, no. If you can do it, that's great. That really helps to the style. I mean, in this arrangement, I didn't use that a lot. But for instance, if you take it here at Carlos Garcia arrangement, he uses that all the time. And it's very effective. I have one of those, and on the intermediate books that you can find at the end. Let me see here. There we go. For instance, this arrangement called Gacheguita uses that device a lot, and it really helps to sound like an orchestra, because usually this connector that you're talking about is played by piano. There you have it. So yeah, if the question is when you can, and if the melody allows you to do it, because sometimes the melody is too long and you need the right hand to play that instead of the connector, okay, you skip it. But if you can, it's great.
So Pablo, I have a question in terms of colors. When you have an orchestra, you have different colors with the bandoneon, with the violin, with the bass, with the piano. Normally, when we play bandoneon solo, when it's a rhythmic part, we'll have to think about the piano and the bass and see how we can quote unquote imitate that feeling, right. Which the bandoneon is a forced sound. The bandoneon, you play a note and you have to cut it yourself. So in order to imitate the piano, what you have to do is have a decay at the end of a note that you will control it with the bellows. Do you have any of those things to do in the piano that will imitate, besides the variation, not playing it legato? Do you think about the violin? How can you have the color of a violin in your solo?
Well, the violin is a tough one, because the violin can hold a note and we can't. Mm-hmm. So there are some winks, I don't know how to say it in English, but there are some little things that you can take from the bandoneon and violin literature to sound more bandoneon-like. Like, for instance, there is the octave, higher octave appoggiatura, that is something that the bandoneon uses all the time, like... Adding that to an expressive part will give some sort of color, like a bandoneon solo. For instance, if we go